So there's a lot of things. I wanted to say, one person asked me, why do you sing so little these days? Well, one of the reasons is I want to hear you sing. And number two is, you sing more beautiful than me, and so I think, I think it is not fair. It's not fair. I know you will not agree by your kindness that I can understand. But not, what's the saying? Over opinions and tastes in art, we cannot argue. So I have mine. And so not much words to be lost here in this regard. Same thing, I must confess something to you. I do like singing. Second thing, I do like talking about Krishna. And I feel guilty because I know many other good speakers are here and all that, and temple presidents and so many young capable persons. So 4 days passed and I be speaking, morning evening. So my mind is also very active. I have been working on many issues, and the last 2 days I have worked on the issue of the future of the Vrinda mission. And for that, I will just share it with you. It's not a final. It's a lot of thinking about it and checking it with all the devotees. But you see, basic design is like that. I'm following the principle of Srila Bhakti Rakshita Maharaj, who was very much adamant that new gurus should start new temples. If there's more spiritual masters in the future, that means we're going to have more temples. According to that design. We don't want people sitting there and fighting over a few bricks and saying, hey, yeah, this is my brick. No, I brought it. Whatever. So, Srila Srila Maharaj told us about Yogapith and also about places like Radha Govinda Ji Mandir of Srila Rupa Goswami, that they are part of our sampradaya, they belong to us, but it is a disturbance if some person says, hey, this is here the temple, and I am the pujari, and you have to be my disciple, because I'm sitting in this temple. That is something which later was called the zonal guru. We don't believe in that. The guru-disciple relationship is a very transcendental relationship, and nobody should interfere with that, practically speaking. So, there are places like the Yogapith where Lord Chaitanya appeared. This is a place, it's a sanctuary for every Gaudiya Vaishnava. And then when Prabhupada left the world, Srila Maharaj said the same thing, hey, his main temples like Krishna Balaram, like Mayapur, they should not be dominated by any spiritual master in particular. Let the spiritual masters visit there with their disciples and contribute, but let nobody sit there and say, this is my place now. We have seen many politics in this regard. Even big places like Mayapur, big places. There's one group says, oh, you have to be a Bhakti Charu. disciple. And the other one says, no, you have to be a Jayapataka Maharshi disciple. And this way there's a rivalry going on. It doesn't fit for such a place which Prabhupada opened with many of his disciples. Even when I was in Sweden, we donated for making rooms there. So, in Vrindavan, in Mayapur. So, when many people do something together, it's not fair that after the guru disappears, anybody tries to claim it. Say, hey, this is mine now. And you either like it or leave. So to avoid that, I have been thinking a lot about that, because I mean, I have a lot of experience of seeing Vaishnava missions after the disappearance of their spiritual master. I've seen, I can write a university thesis about that, because I've seen in the case of Srila Puri Maharaj, case of Srila Daitamadva Maharaj, case of Bhaktivedanta Bond Maharaj, okay. Is numerous Srila Bhakti Vichavishnam, Bhakti Vaibhav Puri Maharaj, and my own Guru Deva, my own Sannyas Guru. I've seen it many times, so I have a pretty clear idea what can and what cannot. Of course, I'm going the very risky way. The risky way is that I trust you to do a good job. And if you don't, okay, somebody else will. And that somebody else will not be able, nobody will be able to restrict the others from developing. It is a system based on love and trust. I was in Sweden, and Srila Prabhupada wrote me a letter in 1974. He said, you have to decide who is getting initiated there, and you just send me the names, I will send you, and you conduct everything there. So I was a little chap of 22 years old, and now I was supposed to decide who gets initiated to recommend them to Prabhupada, because Prabhupada wasn't there. And that was the system of those days. So Prabhupada made many revolutionary statements, but the essence of it all is that we need people who are taking responsibility. Now, what does that mean? There's spiritual responsibility when you give a class. Spiritual responsibility when you worship the deity. Spiritual responsibility when you receive the guests in the entrance of the temple. Spiritual responsibility when you conduct the Ishtagosti. Spiritual responsibility and material responsibility when you're a treasurer and an accountant, where you manage the money of the temple. So there's kind of different important people in the management of a Krishna conscious society. Prabhupada showed us that he trusted all of us. And because he trusted us so much, therefore his movement grew so amazingly. And of course, sometimes also things went down the hill, because somebody didn't behave trustworthy. But then Prabhupada didn't turn around and said, oh, somebody was not trustworthy, now I'm not going to trust any one of you anymore. No, Prabhupada never took that attitude. Even though he could have, but he knew what he was doing. He said, let's trust. Trust, love and trust, it's the chance. You have to try it. How far can you go? What will you achieve? So these are many things. I know, I realize I'm saying many things which for you are subject you never thought about it, because you were never in that position that you had to think about it. Because when a mission is working nicely, the guru is there, and his disciple never think twice. They say, Jai Gurudev, what you tell me, Jai Gurudev. Huh? So it's not much conflict in that area. But when the guru is not there, then, and every guru leaves the world, we know that, no? So, who are you going to obey to? Only to somebody who you love and trust. So you have to find that person who you love and trust, who you want to conduct your Krishna consciousness with. And that is something where we're going to get some helpers. Now, you must have all heard at some point of the famous GBC letters called Governing Body Commissioner. This actually comes from Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. And today there's GBCs in ISKCON, there's GBCs in many Gaudiya Maths, they also have that. In our mission we call it CBA. That comes from Spanish, means Centro Brahminico de Copio. But for us it means the Brahminical Center of Protection. Of protection of the sanity. Actually, that's how I translated it here. So, what we do, and we have already started this, we appoint certain amount of CBAs. All the presidents and the ex-presidents, they are also CBAs. The sannyasis and maharanis, they are also natural CBAs. That means their voice and their vote will always be taken in consideration. But then we have some administrative CBAs. And these administrative CBAs, they are people, they know about accounting, legal management, how to do something properly, so that a mission will not be spoiled by some administrative mistakes. Now, in the years I have had many administrative tackles, and in order to tackle them well, you have to be quite engaged and quite smart. So these protectors, Brahminical protectors of the different steps of the, they will be able to give good advice on the administration and also on trustworthiness. So you could say, if I just look around here, for example, how many temple presidents we have? Lift up your arms. Temple presidents, arms up. Okay. Krishna Kiran, you're not temple president? Okay. So that means you're already CBA. Then, how many ex-temple presidents we have here? Who were temple presidents before? So, there's more CBAs. They are the people who are actually ready to take responsibilities and who are caring for the mission and they want it to work. So these people, but we don't need all of them for an opinion. That's what kills the GBC in ISKCON. Because they have so many cases to take care of. And they have a few GBCs, only 24 or something. And they never have time to even listen to all the cases. So when they make decisions, they're not based on having evaluated the circumstances. I have first-hand experience of that. So our CBAs, they can work 5 in normal situations. In special situations, like purchasing a building for Krishna, they should have 9. 9 of them approving it. So that it's a very serious consensus. As far as selling buildings is concerned, we don't want to sell anything which is Krishna's. unless there's such a strong case that everybody will automatically agree. Then it goes to a different level. So here we go. The main temple should be protected. They should be protected that there's nobody there claiming rights over the others. So how do you do that? How do you manage that? Well, I give you a list of such temples. We are calling Vinda families, Ishtadevas, who should be open to worship and management, Seva, by all who do not initiate new disciples. Only when no capable devotee volunteers initiated by the founder Acharya or his successors and who are submissive to the opinion of these CBA advisors are existing, some initiating guru in the line may take the charge with his disciples. There may be some place, there's a guru, he's in charge, there's a temple, he's the only one doing work in that area. That temple was opened long time ago, but they say, come on, you take care of that, because there's no group claiming, because a group is claiming for worship also has to be a group giving donations to maintain it. So there, it's something like that. Again, everything I'm saying, this I heard from Srila Maharaj. He advised that for our God brothers in ISKCON. He advised them that the main temple should be kept open for everybody. But they didn't follow his advice, but they distributed the big temples amongst themselves, one New York, one Mumbai, one Vrindavan, like this, and then the problem started. Later they tried to change that, but they were never really able to correct the situation. So for that we want to avoid that. So rather Braja Mohan Vrindavan is a temple must be open for all. Gauranga Radha Brajeswara Ishtadev Mulamat of the Vinda Mission, Radha Govinda Mat Chile, Radha Madan Mohan Mat Argentina, Radha Damodar Mat Truly is Peru, Radha Raman Mat Bolivia, Radha Vinod Mat Venezuela, Radha Sham Sundar Mat Uruguay, Gandharvika Giridhari Sao Paulo, Radha Gopi Balaba Hungary, and Gandharvika Govinda Sundaram Berlin. These temples figure amongst the list of to be kept out of one particular acharya. Means in those temples, after I leave, we need to have a few acharyas who initiate in that area, or whoever, whatever solution Krishna will give to us. And they can all come and they can all participate. And those who are not initiating, they can stay in Berlin and manage this thing as CBAs, make this temple flourish. Now we have many little recommendations that will take some time to study. I will give you just a short reading. Other deities can be worshipped and managed by new acharyas. The temple Ishta Gosti and CBAs can choose such an acharya who agrees to take responsibility. Means in the case of my departure, then they can choose the local devotee who is there to look after things. Maybe I have already given indications previously, maybe not. So that is that decision. But you cannot appoint somebody as an acharya. Acharyas are self-revealed. You can give an indication, but when somebody is becoming an acharya, first he has to accept that service, and then others have to accept him as the guru. This is entirely voluntarily. You do not apply any legislation to that. Otherwise you kill the whole thing. That is something that has to be born in the world of Sharanagati only. So the deity worship should follow Archana Khan. Only install deities if at least 5 people can participate voluntarily in the puja. Like already in Berlin, we are in some problem. We need more people voluntarily participating in the puja. That was my condition long time ago for installing deities in Berlin. I want to see more community participating. Otherwise, it's not very good standard, because one person just cannot do that alone. Acharyas, sannyasis, maharanis, and presidents, plus the administrator, search to be CBA, they take important decisions which require a single majority of 7 CBAs. Of those 7, at least 5 should be active protectors of the family. We prefer to have people actively involved, like Radha Vrindavan Chandra. She is an active protector. She took over the administration in Berlin, and what was previously a big unorganized thing, she turned it into something where we now have clear numbers. We know what's going on in Berlin. Her and Satyavati, they have done a good job. In our mission, we have many previously established CBAs. They are Krishnananda Acharya, Mriganath Acharya, Atulananda Acharya Maharaj, and then there's many sannyasis who are active. Then there are also CBAs as well as Maharanis. We also have a few special pillars, like Panchatattva Prabhu, who has been managing our office for the last 30 years without a stop. I don't know how I deserve to have such a secretary who never stopped doing his seva, despite many trials. Then we already have some new missions coming up. New missions means my sannyasis who got the blessings to start new branches of the Vrinda family. Like Giri Maharaj, who started the Bhakti Alok mission in Argentina. It belongs to Vrinda, but it is simultaneously one and different. That means he is also giving Harinam in this. New members of the CBR receive a training, and 3 years they have to be in that training to be accepted as a full member of CBA. We want to see how they perform. They're the trusted people, and very important, a CBA member doesn't come into the temple as an authority. He comes into the temple as a friend of the temple president. But he has permission to go into every department, participate in all the meetings, talk to all the devotees. There's no secrets before him, but he or she comes like a friend. And they can see, is this temple well managed or not? And if they see it's not well managed, then they help to manage it well by giving suggestions, by taking up services which are required. That the CBA are very surrendered souls who are really caring for the purity of the mission. But as I said, they don't come in as an authority. They come in as a friend. That is the big difference between the GBC of ISKCON. GBCs of ISKCON, they would just come in, be the absolute authority. Many times they didn't even know the devotees who are there. They didn't know the local situation, but they are the maximum authority, and then they make some weird decisions and leave. So the CBAs should be people who are living there and have an idea of what is going on. they are also ratified. In other words, the presidents and the local boards, they can choose who they want to have as CBAs in their area. They are not imposed upon them. It's a loving teamwork of transparency. The CBA, the body of CBAs, are the advisors to all for a proper administration, center of Brahminical rectifications. All successfully loved Ritvik gurus can become Diksha gurus and open new projects. They must know the Vaishnava philosophy. So, Gurudev Atulananda, myself, we have really wondered about what is the future of this mission. And even though our mission is not very big, it's far spread. It looks bigger than it is. But even though, because we give so much freedom to the devotees, it's not an exaggeration that we have 200 centers where some kind of preaching is going on. Now, 200 centers, they get out of sight. Plus, when they're in different languages and different countries around the world. So, therefore, Gurudev Atulananda and myself, we decided to start appointing Ritvik Acharyas who can conduct the initiations on our behalf when we are not coming for a while. Who are these people? Well, we will choose them. We will choose them by where we have the greatest confidence that they can do that. I will appoint a few of them right now, but not enough. Krishna Vilas is one of them for Switzerland. He can choose if somebody is ready for initiation there, and if he wants to give on my behalf initiation, he can do so. This is an example. Sannyasis can do that. People who are aware, they are participating in the mission and they have gained the confidence. But in Munich, he can do that. No need to clap now. I'm just giving you an idea, no? I'm giving you an idea of what the structure, what's happening. It's appointing powerful people in different locations who, of course, have to be regarded specially also. Because if they're not, if the Ritvik Acharya is not regarded as anybody special, then also it will not be very happy. So here, Krishnananda Acharya, of course, he's Acharya, but also on behalf of mine, Swarup can do this. He's very settled in his ways. So, of course, for somebody to do it, it's not only that I appoint him, he also has to agree. And plus, I will also choose some Matajis to do that seva also in our family. Because I follow the principle that we are not this body, and I follow the principle that in our lineage, great women have done great seva, and they have shown such a criteria. They have often saved the mission. So therefore, also, that is of course something very, very important to decide who can do such a thing. Who can have that fine feeling and who are also dedicated non-stop to the local community. That's another criteria. That there has to be a great degree of dedication and criteria. So I can think of somebody like Lalita Madhava. She's a very apt person for specially taking shelter giving shelter to the ladies when they come. And of course, that has to be personally worked out in the community. But I will, as long as I live, I will be straight on top of it and look how it works. I'm just explaining to you this system. We have chosen in Gurudev Atulananda, myself, in one of our journeys, we choose some 60 people amongst Matajis and men for doing that seva. Officially, we have not even launched that list to everybody's awareness. And this is a work I did the last days. So you're the first one to hear all this. You're the first one. Last time you were the last one when it came to the Gayatri Mantra first line given to everybody, but somehow or other I went to Europe and I didn't say it. And that is 15 years back or so where we made this adjustment. So sometimes happens. So Mataji, which hasn't had yet the first line of the Gayatri, please come to me and we will give it to her tomorrow morning. I think we already gave. So you get an idea. I'm working hard to give a future without court cases, without struggles to all of you, where you can happily go on preaching. And if you have a good group you do it with, good luck. And if you don't find a good group to do it with, then start a new one. You learned enough in all these years. You have seen what I did, you have seen what many others did. So if you really want to start something better, it's no problem starting a new temple. If you're dedicated, you can go anywhere and start a new temple. Maybe go slowly, maybe take some time before you get the first students. But I've sent many people out who the only qualification they had was the desire to do it. And they managed so nicely. I can give you plenty of examples. So therefore, if you have, now very important is, elders are those honorary CBAs who have done much in the past and are favorable to the new administration. Thus they are respected and consulted like CBAs. Elders like we know that they have come for years, maybe some God brothers who are very favorable to us. And we may consider to be a CBA for our mission, like Vishnu Maharaj, we can make him an honorary CBA. Bodhain Maharaj, we can make him an honorary CBA advisor. Acharyas from other missions also. Again, this will be up to me to decide. And maybe in the future, we invite others who show great capacity. The CBA should be 50% Matajis in the administration help group. Matajis have qualified themselves very much in administrative things and in caring topics. So for those who are looking after the administration of the temple, at least 50% have to be Radharani's female servants to make sure the mission is going, staying on track. So this is this one. Now comes the treatise of today. Here it is. The CBA of Vrinda stands for Center of Brahminical Administration or Rectification. Rules for the survival of the Vrinda family and future branches. Krishna consciousness expands by the grace of Krishna and his empowered agents. They may be sannyasis, maharanis, temple presidents, important guardians of the proper protection of properties and management of the official registrations. Every temple and project should have a published list of rules and regulations to make sure all involved know the ideas of Krishna and the founder. Of course, a temple president has an immense criteria what to do, what not to do. But there should be some rules. So if somebody breaks the rules and is not coming to some good understanding to be a good contributor to the community atmosphere, then he can pull out the rules and say, sorry, pal, you're breaking here these rules. We can't sustain your presence here in the temple. Otherwise, the temple president has to have the last word of who he wants to live with, basically. For normal decisions, the temple president or director is enough, with the backing of the local CBA members who guards the official legal proper behavior of the temple or project. Big decisions like buying places or managing more than 5,000 euros must be revised by the president, minimum three CBA members in written form. The local Brahminical parliament must also be informed. General rule: no properties used for preaching should be ever sold. Number two, no property of Krishna should be used as guarantees of any loans. I don't like to live with bank loans. So if we do have a loan, then we try to pay it off as quick as possible. If five CBA members agree that a certain CBA member became disqualified, he or she loses the CBA status. So it's easy gained and easy lost if somebody does nonsense. CBA is a status to be a volunteer to enter any temple department to help it to function up to perfection. CBA participate in all meetings with voice and voting power. They can try to move manpower to areas lack of attention may produce any danger. Vrinda tries to be the least bureaucratic possible. We like the Sadhusanga meetings and discussing how to do the things properly. They are necessary, but we don't want to be bureaucratic. We want to have the people there who really believe in what they're doing. Meetings which should take place, weekly temple or project meeting, in emergencies up to daily. Monthly report to all active devotees in the area. Report meeting. Every 3 months, a Brahminical parliament of maximum 6 temples. Here, CBA are authorized by the joint vote. Like for somebody become a CBA in the 6 temples, he has to be selected by those 6 temple presidents. They all have to agree, yeah, he's somebody who can come in here and tell us something as a friend. Every 6 months, a country meeting should be held. Spiritual masters have the last word in the service of their disciples, but should always consult and harmonize with the CBAs protecting the local projects. It's an important thing. That was a problem in ISKCON. They didn't know how to manage that. They took away the power from the guru, saying no, the guru has nothing to say about his disciple, which becomes a big disturbance in the mind of the disciple. So it's the guru has something to say, but he should not ignore the local necessities. Spiritual masters should open new centers. In the Ishtadeva mantirs, their voice and vote is like a CBA member. Minimum 9 CBA members should be appointed protectors of an Ishtadev project or of the book publication Seva. In other words, where we have one of those main temples, there should be a good group watching that this is actually properly managed, not one or two. So, and in where the book publishing goes on and money is being sent, also good transparency must be achieved. Any new property purchased should have 5 active CBA members to protect it, especially. Prabhupada said 3, I increased it to 5. New CBA members are on trial for 3 years to show what they can do. Then 5 other CBA members in the area will make them a full CBA member. Local temples can reject a particular CBA member from taking part, but cannot reject other CBAs to come to check. A good reason should also be given for rejecting a CBA's participation to the local monthly forum. The Ishtadev Mandirs have a group of non-initiated devotees administrating. That I already explained before. There can be different gurus in the Sangha. All gurus are allowed to visit and contribute with donations and manpower. The disciples can put their guru's picture on the altar when they do artik, but Ishtadev Mandir should be freed of guru politics. Devotees who join there are requested to wait 1 year before they choose their Diksha Gurus. After initiation, they should continue their service in the Ishtadev Mandir, preferably, because they joined that Mandir. So they should also help that project. There are no hard rules. Everything should be done in harmony. The idea is that in the future, members of branches from the original guru shall be allowed to visit and refer to the Ishtadev Mandir as their original Mandir. Example, Radha Govinda Mandir or Yoga Pit Mayapur are places of the Sampradaya. One exclusive guru system is not desirable there. If not enough help is coming from the branches, 5 CBAs and the local Brahminical parliament may request a guru with his disciples to take over and administrate. Preferably, such guru should be from the line of the founder or his godbrothers. In the absence, another successful spiritual master can be invited to maintain the worship of the Ishtadev Mandir. Noi Summit 2017. You know, as I say, this is something which is, we are working on it. But what specially inspired me to work this out, because I've spoken a lot about it, and you have heard about CBA and different things like that, but I haven't had the complete picture explained. So I thought it is just timely to give you an idea what this future looks like. And in the end, you should preach with those who you love and you trust. It is sincerely my hope that from the Vinda mission, many missions will evolve. Of course, that's up to their lordship. How many real people will take responsibility and will say, yes, I want to continue the line of Srila Prabhupada. I can tell you it's a very hard job. I don't recommend it to anybody. But some people may feel the need to do such a thing, because it's like somebody says, marriage is terrible, difficult, but still we recommend and we marry people, no? Even though there is such a hard job to bring up a family in this world. And anyone who does that, he should give all the honor to them for being bold family members. So in this way also, being a Ritvik Guru, being a Diksha Guru, being a Shiksha Guru, according to Srila Sridhar Maharaj, every devotee is a Shiksha Guru of a kind. So we believe in the Hindu Dharma, but we don't know much about it. We believe in Srila Prabhupada, and we have seen what happened after he left the world. So we also have to believe in our common sense and in our own devotees, because if you don't believe in your own devotees, you have nobody to work with in the future. So, therefore, time will tell. And I really hope time will tell us wonderful things. I believe so. I really believe so. I believe this will be very wonderful, and we will have so many spiritual dynamic families. And there's something very important. Because I'm secretary of the World Vaishnava Association, Vishwa Vaishnava Rajshabha. You better be sure to be part of that as well, from the feeling of it. You have to know what is the World Vaishnava Association in Switzerland. What is the World Vaishnava Association in Czech Republic? What is the World Vaishnava Association in Hungary? If you don't know, then you don't know where you're part of. We are not independent. I explained that before. I worked for the WVA only so that our devotees can have a feeling of belonging to the original Sampradaya. Not depending on some knuckleheads and their mediocre meeting where they come up with some mistaken conclusion and they may say, oh no, you are not connected. And then you go, oh my God. So when we started the Vrinda family, we were looking for this guidance and we got it from Srila Bhakti Rakakshila Maharaj. Later, we got it from Srila Bhakti Pramod Puri Maharaj. Later again, we got it from Srila Bhakti Balabh Tirtha Maharaj and from many others afterwards. Bhakti Vaibhav Puri Maharaj also. So we did get that, but officially, institutionally, we are getting this from the Vishwa Vaishnava Rajshabha, where we obviously are a member organization. I'm sure it's even stated in the statutes. And I personally registered 20 years ago the Vishwa Vaishnava Rajshabha in India. It was started 500 years ago, but recently 20 years ago it was registered. Because in old days people were only registered in the books. There it was registered by Srila Jiva Goswami in his Sandarbhas. He registered the Vishwa Vaishnava Rajshabha, but otherwise there was no registration. So, therefore, I wanted our mission, our devotees, to feel I belong to something genuine, connected to the great acharyas of India, so that you also may continue your devotional service in the lineage connected to the acharyas. You also should feel that and follow that. Then you will be successful, and the people you initiate will also feel comfortably connected. In addition to that, and that's a bit strange, please don't misunderstand me, but in addition to that, I was recently appointed the secretary for South America and Central America of the Vishwa Hindu Parishad. Let me explain to you what is the Vishwa Hindu Parishad. It sounds so similar, Vishwa Vaishnava Rajshabha. You may almost think, oh, it's the same thing. No, nothing to do with each other. Vishwa Hindu Parishad is the organization of India to uphold the dignity of Hindu religion in the face of the whole world, where they have been presented by colonialists and by all this as primitive, as aboriginal, as nothing good to offer, and all that. Hinduism has been trampled upon. So the Vishwa Hindu Parishad is an intellectual organization which just recently organized a World Congress in New Delhi. We went there to this Congress, and that when it started the negotiation for becoming representative for South America, which just 1 month or 2 months ago, they gave me the official assignment for starting the Vishwa Hindu Parishad all over Latin America and for establishing our educational curriculum in front of the school books of the whole world. If they say we don't know what Hinduism is all about, our curriculum book will tell them. And they better follow our book, because they can't speculate about us. We will not simply accept that. So, and that carries further on, because if you then a Hindu and the Hinduism is accepted in your country, then you can go to school, you can go to military service, and you can request vegetarian food because you're a Hindu, and they have to accept that, they have to respect that. So it has many, many, many implications. And I accepted that responsibility. As a matter of fact, I am establishing 11 core members of the Vishwa Hindu Parishad in every country. In Germany, they already have a registered Vishwa Hindu Parishad. I don't have to do it here. But in Hungary, we just spoke about this today. In Switzerland, I'm sure we do not have it. I request Krishna Vilas to investigate that. Of course, that in South America, it's quite some job we have to do, that I have accepted also on behalf. But this time, it is in defense of all the groups from India, whether Brahma Kumaris or whether they are the followers of Ramdev Baba, whoever. It is going to be a very joint platform for showing the world the greatness of what Bharatavarsha is and has to offer. And that's a lot. Much more than most people imagine. Even our own people, they love Prabhupada, but they don't know everything what the Vedic culture has to offer. So, I just give you a few examples. The first thing we have to do is create an ad hoc committee of 11 members. Of those, there should be maybe half from the Indian local community and half of the local Indian local yoga communities, devotee communities. Revise the registration statutes I'm sending out. We have the official registration statutes and adapt them to the local law. For Sweden, we are also doing this. Hold meetings. 4. Present the teacher's Hindu education book from VHB England to the Culture, Religion and Education and Defense Ministry for approving Hindu practitioners to have a recognized statute. 5. Register formally. 6. Conduct culture events through the Vishwa Hindu Parishad. Now, my mentor in this, his name is Swami Vigyanananda. He gave me the advice, which I smiled because I have my own experience. Said, choose 11 people who are not going to fight with each other. He said, make sure whoever joins this 11 committee is not on a big ego trip and is ready to listen and find some consensus. 11 members, so there's always a majority when it comes to some voting things. But he said that Hindu Gemeinde, Hasan Heidi should have listened to that. That is this fighting over little things, this is immaturity. We are not supposed to do that. If things are to be worked out, we should work them out in whatever humble way it can be done, but not fighting. So that was a recommendation he made for me for founding the core committees, and I pass it on. If you have any idea, if there's any other country where we will do the Vishwa Hindu Parishad work, it's an active work, but then we can work together with that committee for the culture events and other things. It's another preaching tool in one way, if you want to look upon it like that. So look into it in Switzerland, look into it in Czech Republic, look into it what can be done, and then we will see.